Now let's consider the topic of intra-firm trade, which is what happens when resources are transferred within the confines of a single firm, but across national borders. Intra-firm trade doesn't receive so much attention, but actually, according to one estimate, about one-third of all of world trade is within firms. There are also some notable patterns for intra-firm trade. Most importantly, it seems to be concentrated in capital-intensive industries. It's also the case that intra-firm trade flows mostly between capital-intensive countries, which are on average, of course, also the wealthier countries. When it comes to the United States, the country is especially likely to import capital-intensive goods through firms, and an example there would be chemicals. When it comes to labor-intensive goods, such as, for instance, textile products, it's more likely that those goods are bought across borders from separate firms. Paul Entras, who has written one of the best-known studies of this phenomenon, put the question in the following way, quote, "Why are capital-intensive goods transacted within the boundaries of multinational firms, while labor-intensive goods are traded at arm's length?" Another way to put the puzzle is to note that at least when it comes to international trade, there is a higher propensity to integrate firms in capital-intensive industries. Some relevant hypotheses here cite transactions cost theories of the firm, as developed, for instance, by Ronald Coase and Oliver Williamson. For instance, imagine that it's the case that hiring really must be done locally, that there's something about choosing the right labor inputs that cannot be done in some other country far away, but must be done on the spot. Autonomy is important for labor hiring decisions. So then when you have businesses and lines of business which require a lot of labor hiring, that is, labor-intensive production, you will tend to have separate firms. In contrast, imagine perhaps that a large capital investment must actually be planned centrally by one central business group, that perhaps the capital investment occurs across national borders and it's based on cost sharing, but you can't have plants in separate countries doing their own capital planning. You then would end up with a situation where firms with capital-intensive productions would tend to be multinationals. If we put all the pieces together, these hypotheses do in fact appear to explain the data. The capital-intensive lines of production are run by larger multinationals, and the trade across borders is largely intra-firm, and this is for reasons of transactions costs. The lines of production which require a lot of labor, the labor-intensive lines, those require greater local autonomy and greater decentralization, and then when it comes to the final outputs, you tend to have more explicit trade rather than allocation within a multinational. We can't be sure that's the right answer, but it is one interesting way to think about this puzzle, and it does seem to fit the observed data. The basic arguments here, including the numbers, are taken from a well-known piece by Paul Entras available online called Firms, Contracts, and Trade Structure.